the Anishinaabe. Ho.
On August 1st, the expedition finally arrives in Huronia. Since leaving Quebec, over the course of 22 days, the group has traveled more than 1,150 kilometers, paddling mostly upstream and enduring 58 portages. At last, they land their canoes at the village of Tuanche on Penetanguishene Bay. Étienne Brûlé will finally be able to show his new country to his captain Champlain and his friend Thomas.
When I was younger, I explained to my brother Raphael that the Huron's real name was the Wendats, which means the inhabitants of the island. This is the island of the Great Turtle, North America. My ancestors really had fantastic powers of vision since North America has precisely the shape of a big turtle. How could they know that? It's extraordinary. The French gave the Wendat the name Huron because of their Mohawk hairstyle. For them, it evoked the head of a boar called an Ur in French. And the real name for Huronia is Wendeki, the land of the Wendat. Today, Huronia makes up a sizable part of Simcoe County. During the winter, it's pretty quiet. But in summer, it becomes cottage country for 3 million Torontonians.
The newcomers will discover that thousands of Wendats live in Huronia or Wendaki. In fact, there are 30,000 Wendats spread out among four nations: the Deer Clan, the Rock Clan, the Cord Clan, and the largest among them, the Bear Clan. It's the Bear Clan, called the Atsinyawantan, that 5 years ago welcomed Étienne like a native son in 1610. In Wendake, Samuel de Champlain will discover a whole new world. Even Thomas, who has already wintered among the Algonquins, will realize that, despite sharing similar cultures and beliefs, the Huron Wendat and the Algonquin Anishinaabe live quite differently.
The Huron Wendat, who live in large fortified villages capable of accommodating 1 to 2,000 inhabitants, have a more sedentary way of life in comparison to the Anishinaabe or Algonquin families. They dwell in these villages for a dozen or so years, that is, up until the surrounding land becomes less fertile. Then they move and build another village elsewhere and repeat the cycle. In fact, this is the corn cycle, the main staple of the Huron Wendat. For my ancestors, the corn cycle is a gift of Mother Earth, the cycle of life. The Wendat also gather berries, but they are, above all, fantastic farmers. They grow tobacco, squash, and pumpkins, as well as beans and sunflowers.
They plant a great quantity of Indian corn, which grows there finely, and the sunflowers, from the seed of which they make oil.
Wendat girls learn very young how to become corn farmers. In fact, 80% of what the Wendat eat is a type of porridge made of corn, ground with a mortar and pestle, to which they sometimes add fish or meat. This soup is called segemiti. The young Wendat girl even learns how to make beautiful dolls out of corn husks. Just like the Anishinaabe, the Wendat are talented artisans. Women and girls make clothing, accessories, and jewelry. Everything is handmade with patience and skill. Through trade with the French, the Wendat acquire iron tools, such as knives and awls. These make their daily chores and craft work a bit easier. They called the French the Iron People. Although many First Nations were already mining copper at the time, acquiring the power of iron would revolutionize their way of life.
At the age of 12, the Wendat boy begins a vision quest that will lead him to manhood. He learns how to play hard, whether it be at lacrosse or at other games like Duck on the Rock, which is sort of like bowling. Through play, he develops his skill, his sense of strategy, his endurance, and his ability to be a team player. All these will be necessary to survive. He will also compose his Odonwe, his warrior and life song that he will sing at the top of his lungs if ever he has the honor of dying at the torture stake. The young Wendat boy also learns how to make weapons, build and repair a longhouse, as well as the craft of drum making. The drum is the instrument given to humankind by the Creator.
Here, the people live in longhouses. These spacious dwellings made of elm bark can house 50 to 100 people. In fact, the Huron Wendat are a branch of the larger Iroquoian family. They separated from this group to move further north. The real name of the Iroquois is the Haudenosaunee, the people of the longhouse. The Wendat share not only their blood, but also their way of life and a common language punctuated by sounds such as U, An, T, Ny, Ro, and Nun.
Three large families share the same longhouse roof, where they are guided by the wisdom of the woman. They live in a matrilineal society where family lineages are determined through the women. They are the keepers of the longhouse fires, which must never go out.
Among the Wendat, it is in the circle of grandmothers that all the important decisions regarding village life are made. The grandmothers even choose the village chief. We have understood both the importance of maintaining balance and the power of the circle, where in reality, everybody is equal and has the right to hold the talking stick. These are the roots of democracy in Canada. My female Anishinaabe ancestors traveled, portaged, and paddled as much as the men. On the other hand, my Wendat women ancestors lived in a society in which the roles played by men and women were more rigidly defined. Women look after everything that has to do with life, children, food, and agriculture, while male occupations have more to do with death, for instance, fishing, hunting, and war.
At the heart of the longhouses, the legends passed on from one generation to the next are life lessons. For example, one legend tells the tale of a corn husk doll with a beautiful face that spent more time admiring her own beauty than entertaining the children. So, the Creator took away her beautiful face. This legend teaches children about humility and, above all, the perils of being vain.
There is also the legend of the three sisters who like to be planted and grow together: corn, squash, and beans. According to the legend, the three sisters are a gift from the Creator. They are inseparable. When night falls, under the full moon, they take the form of beautiful young women who dance under the shadow of the cornfields as they sing the praises to the mother of us all, the earth. Today, I no longer have to hide my culture the way my grandparents were forced to. We continue to live our traditions, following the cycle of the seasons in the way of the medicine wheel cycle. One day, it will be my turn to teach our legends and our traditions to my children and grandchildren. So goes the cycle of life.
Champlain is amazed by what he sees in the land of the Huron. He visits three more villages.
They received us in a very friendly manner, making for us a banquet with their bread, squashes, and fish. A girl of little modesty came to me and offered to keep me company, for which I thanked her.
According to the rumors and written accounts of the time, it would seem that Etienne Brûlé, on the other hand, did not refuse the advances of a young and beautiful Huron girl. Today, it is still said jokingly, although with some basis of truth, that at one point, half the children in the village of Tawanche were his. 3 cheers for the New World!
This country is very fine and fertile, and traveling through it is very pleasant. Thence, I had them guide me to Caragua.
The fortified village of Caragua is commemorated near the present-day village of La Fontaine. Since the Huron Wendat moved their villages around every 12 or 15 years to ensure that the soil remained fertile enough to grow their corn, there are no doubt still many former village sites that have yet to be discovered. At Caragua, Champlain is reunited with a dozen other Frenchmen, and the one who, too excited to wait for him, preceded him to Huronia, Father Joseph Le Caron.
We found Father Joseph, and were very glad to find him well. On the 12th day of August, the Récollet Father celebrated the Holy Mass, and a cross was planted.
It is the first Catholic service in Ontario where Champlain is present. But Champlain had not come all this way just for the pleasure of exploring the land and paying homage to the glory of God. He must go on the warpath to the land of the Iroquois. The Iroquois of the League of Five Nations live to the south of Lake Ontario. Before winter sets in, a war party must go and teach these enemies a lesson they'll never forget. However, the Huron warriors, like the chief Oranie, thought that Champlain was dead. They're far from ready to leave. First, they must perform their ceremonial rituals. So, Champlain will have time to visit 3 more villages. In Wendake, it is on this point of land that the spring flowers of our history started to bloom with the arrival of the young Etienne Brûlé. Today, Tuanchi is a hamlet, and the bay that surrounds it bears the name of the community that sprang up close by, Pénétanguishin. On August 1st, 2015, it's the writer Daniel Marchildon who has the honor of playing the father of New France during the Rendezvous Champlain held in Pénétanguishin. Like elsewhere in Ontario, the Franco-Ontarians in this area had to work hard to obtain their French language high school. They even had to resort to creating their own illegal school, l'École secondaire de la Huronie, in this former post office. 400 years after Champlain, in the village of La Fontaine, proud and deeply rooted Franco-Ontarians will create the Festival du Loup. This festival will become a springboard for many artists from Huronia, like Jean-Marc Lalonde, Éric Dubois, the famous Damien Robitaille, himself a proud Métis, Michel Pema, and the indomitable Joël Roy. And these singers have inspired many artists, like les Sœurs Lefebvre et les Coureurs des Bois.
On the 17th of August, I arrived at Kayagi, where I was received with great joy and gladness by all the savages of the country.
Located near the village of Warminster, west of Lake Kuchiching, the village of Kayagi is the rallying point of the Wendat army. The headmen Oranie, Darental, and Oshateguin are all present. Oshateguin is the Wendat chief who, along with Chief Iroquois, convinced Champlain to wage war against the Iroquois back in 1609. As they prepare to head out, news comes that the Andastes are ready to join the Wendat and French army. The Andastes are themselves Iroquois Haudenosaunee and live to the south of the enemy League of Five Nations Iroquois. If the Andastes warriors surprise the Iroquois by coming from the south, the attack will come from two fronts and thus be even more successful. Champlain suggests sending messengers to the Andastes to enlist their precious support. The Wendat allies perform the usual ceremonies preceding every important battle.
There was a constant succession of banquets and dances in which they had been for a long time engaged.
Champlain is worried. If all these rituals take too much time, the red leaves on the trees will fall, and it will no longer be possible to hide behind them to surprise the enemy. He grows impatient, especially since after this battle, he wants to return to Quebec before winter sets in and makes him a prisoner of this land.
On September 1st, the warriors have gathered in Orillia, at the narrows where Lake Simcoe flows into Lake Couchiching. During the day, Champlain has admired an ingenious system of fish weirs that the Huron have created. As the group awaits the arrival of still more Wendat warriors, the departing ritual is in full swing. Étienne Brûlé asks Champlain for permission to accompany the messengers dispatched to the Andaste country,
which I readily accorded, as he might in this way see their country and get a knowledge of the people. The danger, however, was not small, since it was necessary to pass through the midst of enemies.
Champlain gives Étienne the date for the big rendezvous, October 10th, which will be the eve of the attack. Godspeed!
In present-day Orillia, there is a school named in Champlain's honor, as well as a magnificent statue representing him. It is not too far from there, in Barrie, that 400 years after Champlain's passage, 400 young Franco-Ontarians from Nouvelle Alliance High School, aided by some proud métis, made a traditional canoe for the occasion and launched it into the waters of Lake Simcoe. According to some sources, it's believed that Étienne and his expedition traveled along the Toronto carrying place. By going down the Humber River, Étienne, en route to the land of the Andaste in Pennsylvania, would have become the first European to see the Toronto area, Hamilton, as well as the Niagara Peninsula.
Modern-day Toronto is now home to tens of thousands of Franco-Ontarians, many coming from a vast array of different origins. Among them, there are Francophone immigrants from Asia, Europe, the Middle East, or Africa, such as my father, Buddy. Toronto is where he landed. The city has become the world's most multicultural place. Every summer, the Franco Fête is held right downtown. The young Étienne, so passionate about the different cultures that he got to experience, could never have imagined that, one day, this city's first French language high school would bear his name, École Secondaire Étienne Brûlé.
On September 8th, Champlain and his allies finally head out for the land of the Iroquois.
On the 10th following, there was a heavy white frost. We continued our journey towards the enemy.
The expedition follows the present-day route of the Trent Severn Waterway, paddling and portaging for days through the Kawartha Lakes, passing through the Peterborough area and Rice Lake as well. As the days pass, the leaves increasingly change into their flamboyant fall colors. Those among the French experiencing their first voyage to the New World are amazed, not only by the spectacle of color, but also by the sudden warmth of this season that exists solely in North America, Indian summer. The forest will soon be cloaked in the colors of fire. Champlain grows anxious. Will the expedition arrive in time to surprise the Iroquois? If the trees lose all their leaves, how will the warriors conceal themselves from the enemy?
The expedition has reached the Bay of Quinte, the site of the future town of Trenton. An important military center for Canada, Trenton has attracted a large number of Francophones and even contemporary explorers who share Champlain's natural curiosity. It's the case of the astronaut Marc Garneau, who has given his name to the local French language high school. Champlain then paddles along Lake Ontario to where the city of Kingston will be built. Before welcoming troops of young Francophones coming here to serve their country, and even before becoming the capital of the United Province of Canada in 1841, the Kingston area was French and Iroquois. Three generations after Champlain, here, the explorer De La Salle ordered the construction of Fort Frontenac on the site of the present-day Kairoc Center. And the courageous Fille du Roi, or King's Daughter, oversaw her own seigneurie, Madeleine de Roibon.
In all likelihood, It's on one of the islands near Kingston that Champlain meets up again with Chief Iroquois and his Algonquin warriors. This headman is an important ally and the one who initially took Étienne Brûlé under his wing. Seeing Lake Ontario for the first time, Champlain and his companions marvel at its vastness. Astounded, they observe the hundreds of wild geese preparing to embark on their journey south. The migration of these flocks of Canada geese rank among the greatest of nature's spectacles. The Huron, Algonquin, and French allies continue their journey following the wild geese as they head south of the Great Lake.
The savages concealed all their canoes in the woods near the shore.
The allies have landed at Henderson Bay in the American state of New York. Silently, they penetrate into the land of the Iroquois and begin a long 40-kilometer portage. Concealed by the forest, the warriors move swiftly towards the Onondaga village near present-day Syracuse. They must act quickly. October 10th is only days away, and the expedition can't afford to miss its planned rendezvous with the Andast forces coming with Étienne Brûlé from the south.
On October 10th, Champlain and his allies lie in hiding in front of the Onondaga fortress.
At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we arrived before the fort of their enemies.
Champlain is surprised. Étienne Brûlé and the Andast army are nowhere to be seen. One after the other, Darental, Auchateguin, and Huronia ask themselves, why are the reinforcements late? If the attackers wait too long, they risk losing the advantage of a surprise attack. As they reconnoiter the Iroquois fortress, Champlain and his allies are dumbfounded by the reinforced palisade that their musket shot will be unable to penetrate. While they wait for Étienne and the Andast warriors, the chiefs grow worried.
Our design was not to disclose ourselves until the next day, which, however, the impatience of our savages will not permit.
A group of young warriors rush to engage the enemy. Impatient, these warriors ignore the plan laid out by Champlain, Iroquois, and the other leaders. Surprise effect is lost. The attackers are now caught in a trap. Must now intervene with their thunder sticks to come to their rescue. The Iroquois fall back to take up their well-protected positions within the fortress, and the attackers retreat.
We withdrew to the distance of cannon range, out of sight of the enemy.
Before attacking again, The warriors make the necessary preparations as dictated by tradition. They sing their warrior song. My Wendat ancestors could sing this traditional song all night long. They would sing as loud as they could to stir up the courage of their ancestors lying deep within them, but also to intimidate the enemy.
The next morning, October 11th, there is still no sign of Itzien and the reinforcements.
I proposed means which they should use to get their enemies. These were to build a cavalier.
A cavalier is a siege tower high enough to allow the French soldiers to fire their muskets over the palisade walls. Champlain also gets the warriors to make wooden armor, wearable wooden shields to protect them from enemy arrows. The second round of the battle begins. As the Hurons and the Algonquins approach the palisade, the Iroquois hurl insults at them. Once again, the young warriors disregard the orders of their leaders. Reacting to the insult, they attack without their wooden armor. Firing from the top of the siege tower, the French try to dislodge the Iroquois, but to no avail. The Iroquois have learned how to take cover against the musket volleys, and the French have little protection against the Iroquois return fire of rocks and arrows. They are forced to abandon their cavalier. Then, a hail of arrows fell upon them. In a final desperate effort, Champlain orders the warriors to set fire to the palisade. But the wind is blowing in the wrong direction. Total chaos ensues. The cries and shouts of the warriors are so loud that they are unable to hear the orders of Darontal, Iroquois, or Champlain. An Iroquois arrow, traveling at lightning speed, heads straight for Champlain.
À la mer du Nord, au pays d'en haut, plein de merveilles. Je crois en toi, on nous plus fort.
Dans 400 ans, ce pays, toi le rêveur fus accueilli, nourri, guidé par des peuples fiers,
montant dans son la grande rivière.
Un jardin d'idéaux, un monde plus beau. Le rideau se lève sur un